daughter, and she wanted to know a little bit about my coming to this country from Germany. Well, I came in 1925. I was 5 years old, and I didn't know any English. But my aunt in Germany had taught me to say 1, 2, 3, and handkerchief. And of course, that's all I knew. And when I came to this country, went down on the street to meet some of the kids. They would ask me, what's your name? And I would say 1, 2, 3, handkerchief, and they'd beat me up. And on top of that, I always wore short pants and an apron, as German kids did, to keep their clothing clean. And American kids don't wear aprons, particularly boys. So that was kind of a reason for them to beat me up too. And another strange thing that happened, but my dad came over a year before us, because we were so poor that we saved up, the family saved up enough money to send him over in 1924. And then he got a job here, and he saved his money, and then sent for my mother and me a year later. And we had an apartment in Manhattan on 111th Street. And one morning, my mother looked out the window, and there was a dead horse in the street. And in those days, they still had a horses pulling the trolley cars. And Mom was kind of shocked at this. And the next day, she looked out, and the horse was still there. 3 days later, it was still there. And my mother started crying and asking my father, what kind of a place did you bring me to when they leave dead horses in the street? I don't want to go back. So, anyhow, that was my introduction to the United States.
I'm Kat. I'm Richard Noss's granddaughter. Opa lived an amazing life, and he had incredible stories. A couple of years ago, I decided to sit down with him and a camera, and I recorded over 2 hours of interview footage. By this point, he had already suffered a stroke, and his health was failing. So he didn't quite recall as many details as maybe he has in the past. I'd like to share with you some of those stories.
Started in Pittsburgh. It's the real career. And for 6 years I played there. And for the first 3 years, it was the conductor was Fritz Reiner, who was a very famous, world-famous conductor. And Reiner and I got along very well. And Reiner finally left Pittsburgh. And he became a member of the Metropolitan Opera conducting staff. And Reiner called me and told me that I should try to arrange to play an audition. And I asked him, well, will you be there? Because I felt, you know, I was a little young player, not that sure of myself. And he says, no, I can't be there because I will vote for you. But if I'm there, Stiedry will vote. If he knows I vote for you, he'll vote against you because Stiedry hates me. You know. This was in the springtime. I was in New York and I went to the Met. And I spoke with the manager of the orchestra, and he said, we're not having any auditions yet. We're not even sure that there's an opening. He said, come in the summer when we announce any, if we announce any auditions, you're certainly welcome. And I said, well, I have to re-sign in Pittsburgh within a month, so I would like to be able to play now. And he, I guess he liked me or something, but he said, well, look, this was a Monday. And he said, tomorrow we go to Philadelphia. If I can line up some conductors, would you come tomorrow morning and play for them? And I said, sure. So as it happened, I came in the morning, and there was Fritz Diedrich, and the big conductor at that time was another German, and no Reiner. And I played the audition on the English horn, and I heard Stiedri say to the other German conductor, and he didn't know I spoke German, and he told the other conductor, he said, we must have this man. And they talked about it for a while. I said, Papa, we're going to have auditions. He said, no, we have to have this man, you know. So I'm thinking, oh boy. And the manager of the orchestra came and got me, and he was an Englishman. He didn't speak German. He didn't know what the hell they were talking about. And he thanked me for coming. He says, you realize, of course, that we will have regular auditions in the summer. I said, well, I only wanted to be able to play for you, you know, meantime. And then I went back to Pittsburgh, and I left a message with, I told the orchestra manager, John Mundy, well, look, if there's any change, I'd appreciate if you call me. And I left him my phone number in Pittsburgh. Called up the next day and said, we want to offer you the job. And I was, wow.
You for so long.
Judy!
How are you?
How are you?
Good to see you.
Good to see you. Happy to disappear for a couple hours. Hey. How are you? Good. Yeah. He's
around. Yeah. How are you doing? Okay. And how about Mama?
Marion, first of all, was this new girl in the orchestra. So the first thing, the first cellist, Yasha Silberstein, she came to the orchestra, sat in the cello set and played her part. And during intermission, she went off on the right side, away from everybody, and sat out in the hall by herself with this crossword puzzle book. Figured I'd make some time with this new kid, see what she's like, you know, and sat down next to her, you know, hi, and we had introduced when she came into the orchestra, and I said, you know, I see you like crossword puzzles. She said, yes, and I said, may I see them? Figuring I'd give the kid a hand, you know. Well, I started reading this thing. I had no idea how the hell she got any answers out of this. What was this all about? Nothing like I'd ever seen. And then she told me they're British crossword puzzles, which are totally away from the American puzzles. And they're fiendishly difficult. I mean, really difficult. I asked her to show me, you know, teach me what's going on. And this is how we became just friendly, you know. And then I got to like her a lot. I mean, she was... love is beautiful. It really is. And I don't mean... I'm not talking about sex. I'm talking about love. Love is something different. It's a deeper thing. It's a feeling. It's great. And I fell in love with her.
Thank you.